गुड इवनिंग गाइस, आई एम ऑडिबल?
गुड इवनिंग सर।
गुड इवनिंग सर।
या व्हाट वाज द लास्ट, सो व्हाट वाज द लास्ट टॉपिक वी वर डिस्कसिंग यस्टरडे?
सर, इट वाज रिलेशन बिटवीन मैग्नेटिक परमियबिलिटी एंड मैग्नेटिक ससेप्टिबिलिटी।
मैग्नेटिक ससेप्टिबिलिटी, राइट? सो दैट वाज द एइथ टॉपिक। So apart from that, is there any other doubt you guys have from yesterday's class? Because I know those were all tricky topics. So there's the one we saw, right? Mu r is equal to 1 plus chi m. Right? Now we will see the next topic, that is, I told you I'll explain hysteresis effect later, right? That is this thing. So if you observe the term hysteresis effect, then diamagnetic substances do not have anything like hysteresis. Paramagnetic substances do not have any hysteresis. Whereas the ferromagnetic substances have something called as hysteresis loss. Okay, this is an important term because in the next chapter, we'll be learning about a device called as transformer. In the transformer, this is one of the main losses when you use iron cores. Okay, so listen to this carefully. If there is any doubt, get it clarified. Now listen. Refer your notes and tell me what is the relation between B and H. There was an important relation that we saw yesterday. B is magnetic induction, H is magnetic intensity. So what is the relation between these two? B is equal to mu into H, right? Now listen, guys. So if B is in this direction, H is in this direction, and H taken in this direction as well. And B is taken in this direction. Okay. Now, H is the input, you give magnetic field intensity, and B is the output that you generate. When the magnetic field intensity is zero, the magnetic induction in the material is also zero, right? Am I right? So it is going to be zero. So as you keep increasing the magnetizing field intensity, right? If you look at the equation, this is of the form Y is equal to MX. So what would be the expected graph? You will think that the graph will be a straight line passing through the origin. But you know what will be the issue that you'll be facing? As you keep increasing the value of H, this is applicable only for ferromagnetic substances. Please listen to this carefully. When you keep increasing the value of H, the B will increase in accordance like this. That is, for smaller value of H, you can find a larger value of increase in the value of B. Okay. Then you keep increasing the value of H. There will be a particular instance at which B will attain saturation. Clear this? So there will be a point at which B will attain saturation. Now, after the saturation, what will happen is, let's say this is the maximum value of H at which you're attaining saturation. Guys, am I clear till this step? Means the graph will no more be linear. It will increase in such a way that there will be a greater value of magnetic field induced for a lesser value of H. Am I clear, guys?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now I have a question. What if you remove the value of H? That is, let's say, this is an iron material, a ferromagnetic substance. It is placed in the presence of an external magnetic field. Let's say the intensity of this magnetic field is continuously increased. Then what will happen to the magnetism inside this material? That will also increase, right? Now, all of a sudden, if you remove this H, that is, you don't have external magnetic field at all, and the material is ferromagnetic substance. What do you think will happen? Will the ferromagnetic substance immediately lose all its magnetism?
No, sir.
No, right? Then what will happen is, as soon as the value of H is removed, the material will start losing its magnetism, but it is not going to retrace the path. Rather, it will come in a path like this. Okay, so this is the way it is going to increase, and this is the way it is going to decrease. Means, at this value of H is equal to zero, what will happen is, you can find some amount of magnetism retained within the material. That is, the material is able to exhibit magnetism in spite of what? In spite of removing the external magnetic field. And this distance is what is called as retentivity of the ferromagnetic substance. This distance is what is called as retentivity of the ferromagnetic substance. So, 0 to, let me call this point as A. 0 to A in the graph sheet is called as retentivity. As the name suggests, retentivity is the property of the material to retain the magnetism in spite of removing the external magnetic field. Am I clear, guys? I hope it is clear, yes, right? Okay. Now the question is, what if I start applying the external magnetic field? Now, not in the direction from left to right. What if I reverse the polarity? What if I start applying the external magnetic field in the reverse direction? What do you think is going to happen? Remember, this material already has some magnetic field within it. Okay. So when I start applying the magnetic field in the reverse direction, what is going to happen to it?
So the charges will flow in the direction of the magnetic field.
There is no charge inside a magnet. There is no charge inside the magnet. A magnet will have small dipoles that I would have told yesterday.
Yes, sir. Those dipoles will move in the direction.
They will not move, actually. This field and the existing dipole moment will oppose each other.
Okay.
Will oppose each other in such a way that at one particular point, when you increase the value of H in the negative direction, at one particular point, the magnetic induction within the material will become zero. Okay, means this value is minus H comma B. So the meaning of minus H is you have applied the magnetizing field intensity in the reverse direction. That is the only thing. It doesn't mean it is a negative value. You just applied it in the reverse direction to the initial condition. That's the thing. Are you able to understand this point?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, anybody with the name of this distance, let me call this point as Q. Like how the distance from O to A is called as retentivity, can anyone tell me what is this distance? The distance OQ is called as coercivity. So, coercivity means nothing but it is the negative magnetic field intensity that needs to be applied on a material to completely demagnetize a material. Means actually what you did is, from the point O to Q, initially at point O, the material was magnetized. Means it had some magnetic field within it. But what did you do? You applied the magnetic field intensity in the reverse direction and you completely demagnetized that material. When you did this kind of a thing, then the distance OQ is what is called as coercivity. Coercivity is nothing but the reverse magnetic field that needs to be applied to completely demagnetize the magnetic substance is what we call it as coercivity. Let me show you the definition. So coercivity is nothing but the intensity of the applied magnetic field required to reduce the magnetization of a given material to zero. Okay, so what is retentivity? Retentivity is the capacity of an object to retain magnetization after the action of the magnetizing forces ceased. Does that make sense? Are you able to understand? Now, if you keep applying the value of H in the negative X direction, the value of B will again increase and here it will get saturated. And this distance is nothing but minus H max. Here, guys. Now, what will happen if you remove the value of H in this direction also? Again, the material will try to reach this point where it will retain the magnetism which has got acquired in the reverse direction. Okay. And then again, if you start applying the value of H, it will go in this way. Okay. And this loop is what is called as hysteresis loop. Hysteresis means lagging. The basic meaning of hysteresis is lagging. So what I'm trying to say is, as you keep giving the value of H, the value of B is not linearly increasing. Rather, there is a lag in the loss or gain of all these values. Are you able to understand? This loop is what is called as the hysteresis loop. And this kind of a property is exhibited only by ferromagnetic substance. I'll just give you 2 minutes time. Let me know if there is any doubt. Is there any point that you didn't understand?
No, sir.
So everything is clear, right? Now comes an important question. So, if I talk about a material like this, and if I talk about a material like this, then if you observe the retentivity column and the coercivity column, it is more for this material compared to this. So materials which have low retentivity and low coercivity are generally called as soft iron cores. Would have heard this word soft iron core in the case of a solenoid. When you take a wire and wind it around a soft iron core, it becomes a solenoid, right? Similarly, if you have high retentivity and high coercivity, then you can call it as a hard iron core.
Sir, is retentivity and coercivity proportional to each other?
Yes, they are. So that's a good question. Yes, they are. Because more is the amount of, see, if a material is having more amount of magnetization available with it, in the absence of external field, means it has more retention capacity. Right? See, for example, let's take this stuff. Let's say you have a 1 liter bottle and 2 liter bottle, right? Which one will take more amount of energy to bring it to zero? You have a one liter water bottle and you have a 2 liter water bottle. Okay. You're pricking a hole at the bottom of both these water bottles. Which one will take more energy to completely empty the bottle?
The second one, sir.
2 liter.
Because 2 liters. So the 2 liters is like retentivity. Completely emptying the bottle is like coercive. Okay.
Okay.
Sir. That is how you look at it. So I hope it is clear, guys. Once you can go through your textbook as well. If you still have doubts, you can let me know. Okay. And then we are going to see the last part of this chapter, that is the theory of Earth's magnetism. So, do you guys have ever seen, like if people go for a hike or they move in some, like you would have seen in movies and all, right? If they walk through a forest, they will have a compass in their hand and they will try to look at a particular direction, right? Have you ever observed this? Guys, are you able to hear? Yes. So what is basically a compass made up of? A compass will have a needle inside, which will respond to, which will work on the function of torque. You would have seen, right? Compass will revolve. Revolution is possible only when it experiences torque. So when can a magnetic substance experience torque? When it is placed in some external magnetic field. Now the question is, how is a compass in any place able to respond and show a particular direction to us?
Because of Earth's own magnetic field.
Because of the Earth's own magnetism. That is what we are going to learn now. You have to understand. So, one thing is, the reason for Earth's magnetism, there are many theories, but no theory is very concrete to say that this is the reason. It is just an assumption that we are thinking that it is because of this. Nobody is bothered up. Nobody is going to question you on why is Earth having magnetism. But it's all about how you are going to make use of the Earth's already available magnetism. Okay. So that is why the statement starts like this. There is no concrete reason for the cause of Earth's magnetism. However, there are few theories that revolve around it. Some of the theories are mentioned below. For example, see, one thing we know that any material can exhibit magnetism under what scenario? Only when the charges are in
motion, sir.
You need to have the charges in motion. So for Earth to exhibit magnetism, also something similar should happen. So the first one is called as the dynamo effect. What are they trying to say? They say, some people say that the outer core of the Earth has molten iron, so which is in the melted form, right? When it is in that form, it has the capability to move. When they move, so molten iron and other heavy elements in liquid form. So the inner core solidifies under the influence of gravity. Therefore, the motion of the metallic fluids in the outer core of the Earth causes an electric current. Thus, the Earth gets its own magnetic field. And this is one of the theories that is proposed. Okay, what do they say? The outer core of the Earth has molten iron and heavy elements in liquid form. When something is in liquid form, it has a tendency to flow. Right? So, the inner core solidifies under the influence of gravity. So, therefore, the motion of this metallic fluid in the outer core causes the outer core of the Earth causes an electric current, and they are saying that electric current is the reason for the magnetism of Earth, which is being experienced by us. That is one theory. Second is ionization of outer layers. Ionization means formation of ions, right? So this theory tells us that the rotation of Earth about its own axis produces strong electric current due to the ionization of the outer layers of Earth. This produces magnetization due to the movement of ions. However, the magnetic field will be very weak. The dynamo effect is the more acceptable theory. Okay, if this kind of a thing happens due to the ionization, if you are able to see that magnetic properties exhibited by Earth, if you calculate the value of Earth's magnetism, it is going to be very weak. So on a comparative basis with respect to the theory, the dynamo effect is more accepted because of the values of field that you find at certain points. Suppose you want, you can download an app in your mobile and check. You just download the app saying a Gauss meter. Okay, Gauss meter is generally used to measure the magnetic field. You can download it in your mobile. Just click and see. You just hold the mobile, not even close to a magnet. You can see some amount of magnetism values being shown there. It will be in terms of few Gauss. Okay, all that is happening because of the Earth's magnetism. So, if you talk about the Earth's magnetism, there are certain components of Earth's magnetism that we need to know. Okay. So, near the surface of Earth, the magnetic field of the planet can be resolved in different directions. These are the components that are responsible for the magnitude and direction of the magnetic field of the Earth at a given location. So, at each and every location, what will happen is the value of magnetic field will vary because it depends on certain parameters at that location. So, those three are called as the elements of Earth's magnetism. What are they called? Elements of Earth's magnetism. There are three important elements that we need to understand. One is called as magnetic declination, or we can also call it as magnetic variation. Variation is not used in most of the books, but this is also right. What it is, I will explain, don't worry. Second element of the Earth's magnetism is the horizontal component of the Earth's magnetic field. And the third is called as the angle of dip, or the other name for angle of dip is magnetic inclination. Am I clear till this point, guys? What are these three called as? They are called as the elements of Earth's magnetism. Okay, please write it down. So these are the concepts you need to know. What are all the elements of Earth's magnetism? Magnetic declination, horizontal component of Earth's magnetic field, or the angle of dip, or magnetic inclination. Clear? Shall I proceed?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, before I proceed, you need to know certain facts. Okay, these are all the observed effects which are given, and I'm going to explain it to you. That's it. Okay. Listen. Okay. This is called as the axis. Okay. This is called as North Pole. This is called as South Pole. This is called as North Pole and this is called as South Pole. And here some confusing terms are going to come. I want you all to pay utmost attention. Okay. So I call this as axis, right? The more appropriate way to call it is, it's called geographic axis. Geographic axis. Okay. So basically, what do you mean by axis, guys? If somebody asks, define axis, what are you going to say? For example, I ask you to define it. Tell me.
So it is an imaginary line that connects the North Pole to the South Pole.
Very good. Excellent answer. That's right. So it is an imaginary line. So axis basically is one dimensional. If you talk about an imaginary line that is able to connect two poles, North Pole and the geographic North and the geographic South, is what we call it as the geographic axis. Now, if you look at the Earth's magnetism, right? If what did I say this is? I told this is North Pole and this is South Pole. But if you generally look at the Earth's magnetism, right, what will happen is, if you consider along the diameter of the Earth, there is a huge bar magnet existing from extending from the North Pole to the South Pole. Then near the geographic north, you actually have magnetic south. Very good, understand. So near the geographic north, you will actually have magnetic south. But before they could find that there is magnetic south, what they did is they assumed that geographic north and magnetic north exist at the same point. See, this theory, we know it today, but at the point it was discovered, they didn't know that the magnetic south is closer to the geographic north. Am I clear? So what they did is they gave NG for geographic north and NM for magnetic north also. They thought it is magnetic north, but actually what is present in the magnetic north? It is the south pole.
South.
South means, why we are saying it like this is because if you stand on the geographic north by holding any material which senses the magnetic field, you can observe that the magnetic field will be received by you. So who can receive the magnetic field? It is only the south pole. So that is why you have magnetic south pole at that point. Okay, look at the direction of magnetic field itself. The magnetic field lines are actually from the geographic south to geographic north. Okay. I hope it is, I am clear till this step, right? Similarly, so there is another term called as meridian. So what is this meridian? Anybody? Meridian basically means a plane. So axis is one dimensional, it's a line. Meridian is a plane. What do we mean by plane guys? Plane is two dimensional. If you think of a two dimensional plane that is passing through the geographic axis and perpendicular to it, please write down the definition. A plane passing through the geographic axis and perpendicular to it is called as the geographic meridian. So are you able to understand what I'm trying to say? Means it will be in the shape of this rectangle like this. Then this is called as the geographic meridian, right? In a similar way, since Earth is able to exhibit magnetism, the Earth will have a north pole and a south pole. In terms of magnetism, it will have a magnetic north and a magnetic south, right? If you are able to draw an imaginary line, okay, if you are able to draw an imaginary line passing through the magnetic north and the magnetic south, then this imaginary line can be called as what? It can be called as magnetic axis. Okay. Similarly, if you are able to think of a two-dimensional plane passing through the magnetic axis and perpendicular to it, then this can be called as magnetic meridian. Guys, are you able to understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Here comes the question. Okay. There's a very important crucial point that you need to know. See, suppose when you're using a compass, it is going to show you a particular direction, right? So it will show you a particular direction as north and all those things, right? But you know what happens at every point? Generally, what do we think? I told you as they thought in the beginning that they thought that the geographic north and the magnetic north is nothing but south pole. They thought that they both will coincide. Right? But they thought that they both are the same. But you know, in reality, what will happen is at each point, the magnetic north is going to be different. The geographic north and the geographic south are going to be at fixed locations. Whereas on different parts of the earth, what will happen is there will always be an angle that is going to exist between the magnetic axis and the geographic axis, it is because each location has a variation in the angle. Okay, all this is happening because of the rotation of Earth and all those parameters. We need not get into those details. But in reality, what will happen is, whatever direction it is showing, there will be a slight error in it. And that error at a point is occurring due to an important concept called as magnetic variation. Okay. Or I can call it as, yes. It is happening because of the concept called as magnetic variation. So, when you talk about a needle suspended freely in air, it always points in the north-south direction, free from all other attracting forces. And this is known as magnetic meridian. Okay, I've explained what is magnetic meridian. So basically, there is a concept called as magnetic declination or magnetic variation, which is defined as the angle that is existing between the magnetic meridian and the geographic meridian. Or in other terms, I can say the angle between the magnetic axis and the geographic axis is what is called as angle of variation. So please write it down. So what is magnetic declination or variation? It is the angle between the magnetic axis and the geographic axis. Or you can replace it with meridian also. Clear, guys? Secondly, there is something called as angle of dip or magnetic declination. So do you guys know what is the meaning of dip?
Lowering or fall?
Yes, dip means something is falling. Wait, I'll show you. Just a minute. I'm switching on my video. So you're able to see me, right? Now see, guys. No. You guys know what is center of gravity, right? Suppose I take this pen and I want to find the center of gravity of it. What will I do? I will try to hold it at different points and I will check. So you're able to see it is revolving. Similarly, if I hold it this side, it is revolving. So there will be one particular point where I can hold this material where it is not going to revolve at all. Accepted?
Yes.
Are you able to understand? So it is not. So this point is called as the center of gravity. Whereas if I hold it at any other point, you can see a dip that is happening. This side, there is a dip. So there is a dip happening this side. Right? So
yes,
when you take a magnetic compass, the compass needle is exactly hinged at the center. But if you observe, when you try to take it into the external magnetic field, the compass needle along with rotation, it will also vibrate like this. Okay, you can see that there is a vibration taking place in the material like this, and that is happening because of a property called as dip. That is, so the angle, so if this is the horizontal magnetic field, when it is getting dipped, the angle that the magnetic field at this location is making with respect to horizontal is what is called as the angle of dip or angle of inclination. If you ask me why it is actually vibrating, why it is getting dipped, it is purely because of the Earth's magnetic field. That is a phenomenon that is exhibited, and it is the name given to it is angle dip. Are you able to understand this point? So that's what the next topic is. That is, we call it as angle of dip. So how do you define angle of dip, guys? So angle of dip is very simple. This is a magnetic needle. And if you take this as the direction of magnetic field, okay, then the angle made by the magnetic field at a given point with respect to horizontal is called as angle of dip, which is represented by the symbol delta generally. It is not theta, guys. It is generally represented with delta. And the delta is called as angle of dip. Somebody's mic is on, please switch off. Am I clear? So how do you define angle of dip, guys?
Yes, sir.
The angle made by the magnetic field at a particular location with respect to the horizontal is called as angle of dip.
Sir, is that delta of that angle? Is it delta or S?
Delta is angle. Is delta. See, there are two types of delta. This is also delta. This is also delta. These two are Greek letters. Okay. So if I take this as B, then this B can be resolved into two components, BH and BV. BH is what? Magnetic field along horizontal direction. BV is the magnetic field along vertical direction. So B, when you resolve it along horizontal, this will be called as B cos delta. When you resolve it along vertical direction, this is called as B sine delta. Is it clear, guys? So B cos delta is what is called as the horizontal magnetic field. And that is the third element of Earth's magnetism. That's it. So basically, elements of Earth's magnetism are nothing but those physical quantities which are used to describe the magnetic field at a particular location. Am I clear, guys? So B cos delta is what is called as the horizontal component of the Earth's magnetic field. I told you there are three, right? What are they? Magnetic declination, the angle between the magnetic axis and the geographic axis. Similarly, angle of dip, the angle made by the magnetic field at a particular location with respect to the horizontal. Then, horizontal component of Earth's magnetic field. That is B cos delta. Right? So, if you want to calculate the value of Earth's magnetic field at a particular location, which is B, then you need to know the angle of dip. You need to know the, when you know the angle of dip, obviously you can find the horizontal component and the vertical component. Okay. If I call this as H and if I call this as B, can I say B square is equal to H square plus V square, which implies B is equal to root of H square plus V square. Clear, guys?
Sir, is this similarly Pythagoras theorem using Pythagoras theorem?
No, it is parallelogram law of vectors.
Oh, yes. Okay.
Similarly, tan delta will be equal to V divided by H. This is also based on parallelogram law. So, tan delta is nothing but vertical divided by horizontal. Clear?
Yes, sir.
So these are all the formulae that are used to solve problems also, guys.
Sir, can you scroll up one second?
Sure. Is this page?
Yes, sir. One second.
I'll write it down.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So with this chapter is over, guys. Okay. We have come to the end of this chapter. I told you, right? It's a small chapter. We are done with this. I want you all to practice, start studying this. There'll be a test, which I'll announce it by Friday. There'll be a test in a particular day, which I'll tell you soon. Okay. So apart from this, is there any other doubt that you guys have?
No, sir. Will there be any problems in this chapter?
Not much, sir. It's full of theory. It's full of theory only, not many problems. So if at all you have problems, you have only problems based on these values. Actually, it is not even this complicated. I have already given you, no? This is enough. This formula is more than sufficient. You can solve the problem when they give you the exact values. You need not memorize or you need not visualize anything. Just apply this formula, you'll get the answer. Basic trigonometry.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So anyways, if anything tougher is needed, I'll definitely explain. Don't worry. So that's it, guys. Now it is left to you for study. And in the next class, I'll be starting the sixth chapter. But before that, I want you all to revise this and be ready. Okay.
So when will we do that potentiometer parts?
Potentiometer, the video is ready. If you want me to upload, I'll upload it. I've done a clear video on it. I'll upload it. You can go through it. You want to see and you want to ask anything, you can ask. So potentiometer, once they do it, sorry, one minute. Potentiometer, have they taught in your school? Because that is a concept.
Yes, sir, we did that today in school.
No. I'm not talking about teaching. Did they do that activity and experiment?
No, sir. No, sir.
That is the reason I held it up, because you have to visualize something. Anyways, I've done a clear video. Don't worry about it. I've done a clear video on it. It is already there. I will upload it in the app itself. Okay, you can just go through it. If there is any other doubt, you let me know.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, we have the exam next week, sir.
Sorry, I didn't get you.
No, sir. You said you will conduct a test in this chapter, sir. Will you conduct it next week?
Yes, not next week. I will do it the week next to it, because I hope you guys would have got an update, right? That CBSE is going to conduct two exams this year. Did you guys go through that notice?
Yes, sir.
So you know it, right? So I'm very particular that we need to ensure that these chapters are strong. So I'm even thinking that I want to give you a break for next week, where you prepare all the five chapters and be ready also. I'm just thinking about it. I'll come back with it. I'll come back with a plan so that you're strong with the five chapters. And I want to actually conduct a cumulative test. So I'm just deciding on whether I need to conduct fourth and fifth or all the five chapters together. But you will definitely have enough time to study. I'll not rush in that. Don't worry. I'll not put pressure on that aspect. I'll give you enough time to study and ensure that your basics are strong. Okay. But I'm just thinking about it. I'll think and get back on.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So in the meanwhile, you asked me about potentiometer. That alone, I'll upload it. I'll do it in 10 minutes, actually. That is ready itself. I've done it last year. So you can go through it. If you have any doubts, you can reach out to me. Okay. That's it. Any other doubts? Yeah. Any other doubts, guys?
No, sir.
That's it, right? No, right? Good. Okay. There is no doubt. We can wind up this.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.